بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. So in the previous lesson, we did the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala attributes of power, will, and knowledge. In this lesson, we're going to complete these three attributes by studying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's attribute of life. So he says, Shaykh Imam al-Sanusi rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, وَالْحَيَاتُ وَهِيَ لَا تَتَعَلَّقُ بِشَيْءٍ. And life, number four, the fourth attribute whose predication is necessary to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is life, which does not relate to anything. So before I explain this, we want to step back for a moment and we want to see that these attributes, all of these attributes, they have a revelatory basis. So the reason why the mutakallimun are mentioning them is because they are mentioned in the Quran. So although we will come to rational arguments, evidence for the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is characterized by these attributes, the way that the books of Kalam are ordered, they start with the Quran. They look at how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes himself in the Quran, summarize the most important attributes, define what they mean, and then establish rational proofs for the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is really characterized by those attributes. So we want to, as we're going through each of these attributes, we want to look at the scriptural basis for them. So the scriptural basis for all of these attributes is, the Quran is full of them. The Quran talks about these attributes throughout. So there's many verses that talk about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's power, knowledge, and will, and we saw that in the previous class. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's attribute of life, it's mentioned in Ayatul Kursi, Allahu la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyu al-qayyum. Hayy is the one who has hayat, the one who is characterized by hayat. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-hayy, it means he is alive. He's characterized by the attribute of life. Here's another one on the slide here. It says, huwa al-hayyu la ilaha illa hu fad'uuhu mukhlisina lahu ad-din. He is the one who is alive. He is the one who is truly alive. La ilaha illahu. There is no God, there is no deity except him. So make dua to him, call upon him. Mukhlisina lahu ad-din, making your religious observance and compliance sincerely to him. Huwa al-hayyu la ilaha illahu wa fad'uhu mukhlisina lahu ad-din. So here we have the attribute of hayat. It's indicated in this verse. And there's any وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى الْحَيِّ الَّذِي لَا يَمُوتُ, another verse in the Quran, place your trust in the ever-living who never dies. Many verses that describe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as being characterized by the attribute of life. What's the definition of the attribute of life? So as we're going through these attributes, each attribute, it has a definition. And the definitions of all of these seven attributes, these existent attributes, they begin in the same way. They begin by saying that they are beginninglessly eternal, existent attributes that subsist in Allah Most High's entity. We did this in last class, but just a quick review. These attributes, they're existent or they're real attributes. They're different than privative attributes. Privative attributes are saying what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not. These attributes are saying what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. They are things that are true about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by virtue of which we know something about him. The definitions that we're doing, these are not essential definitions. We saw that there's two kinds of definitions, essential definitions and non-essential definitions. Essential definitions capture the essence of the definiendum, the term that is being defined. And the essence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his attributes cannot be known. It's beyond the capacity of the human mind to know them. But we can know certain things about them. And we can know certain things about them that allow us to distinguish them from other things. So we can to identify them. And this kind of a definition is called a non-essential definition. So this is a non-essential definition. So this is a beginninglessly eternal attribute. In other words, this is something that is true about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala since beginningless eternity. There was never a time when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was not characterized by this attribute. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't acquire this attribute. This is the perfection of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is true about him since beginningless eternity. So this is a beginninglessly eternal existent attribute. It has existence. It means that it's something that is true extramentally. It's not just a mental concept in the mind. And that also we explained in the previous class. It's a beginninglessly eternal existent attribute that subsists. So we have exist and you have subsist. Subsist is like subordinate existence. So he says that subsists in Allah Most High's entity by virtue of which. So this is now the distinguishing part of the definition, by virtue of which Allah Most High is characterized by power, will, and knowledge. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we saw in the previous class, through his power, he brings things into existence and takes them out of existence. Through his will, he chooses, he determines. He chooses what things will come into existence and what things will go out of existence. And through his knowledge, everything is revealed to him without there being any prior concealment. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, everything in the universe, it exists because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knew about it since beginningless eternity. He chose for it to be the way that it is. This was also a choice since beginningless eternity. And then he brought it into existence at the time when he had decreed for it to come into existence. Everything in the universe is in the grasp of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's, in Allah's grasp, by virtue of his attributes of knowledge, power, and will. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's attribute of of life. So when we say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is alive, we mean that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not a unliving cause of the universe. So the philosopher, we're going to see in the section on the arguments, the evidence for these attributes, they held that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that the universe came to be necessarily, the universe is a necessary consequence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So for them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was like a cause. And many contemporary scientists who believe in the existence of a necessary being, their conception of a necessary being is similar. They don't hold that Allah, that the necessary being who brought the universe into existence is a being who freely chose to bring the universe into existence and could have, had he willed, chose not to have brought it into existence, or to have brought it into existence in a completely different way. That's not their conception of God. Their conception of God is that God is a cause, just like the natural causes of the universe. So when you have fire, you put something into fire, and fire causes the burning. Fire doesn't have a choice whether to burn or not to burn. So the natural causes, the way that they are understood by scientists, or the way that they would be understood by the pre-modern philosopher, these are necessary causes. Things in the natural causes of the universe, they necessarily bring about their effects without their having any choice in the matter. Allah, and this is what we mean when we say that they are not alive. They are dead. They don't have a choice in the matter. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a living being. This means that he chooses, he creates, he destroys, he knows, and he brings the universe into existence through his free will, through his completely free volition. And things don't have to be the way that they are. And the only reason the way that they are this way is because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose to make them that way. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created the universe and he has put into the universe regularities, burning regularly follows fire, cure regularly follows the taking of medicine, satiation regularly follows eating food, quenching one's thirst regularly follows drinking water, an apple being split into two regularly follows the placing of a knife on the apple and placing pressure on the knife, warmth that we feel regularly follows our wearing clothes, concealing our when we wear clothes, our nakedness is concealed from the eyes of other people, and we no longer feel a sense of shame. And this concealment is regularly followed by wearing clothes. But in reality, there's no necessary connection between the two. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creates the cause and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creates the effect through his attribute of free will. And so the universe is the creation of a living being. the universe is not the necessary consequence of someone who is of a dead and a dead cause that doesn't have the power, doesn't have power, doesn't have volition. The universe is a freely willed creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when we say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is alive, we mean He's a living being who is characterized by knowledge, will, and power. That's what it means for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be alive. A living being. So if you look at the verse, what does the verse say? هُوَ الْحَيُّ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّهُ فَدُعُهُ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ He is the one who is alive. There is no deity, there is no one who is worshipped, worthy of worship except Him. So supplicate to Him, make dua to Him. It doesn't make sense to make dua to something that is not alive. Because something that is not alive, from whom things necessarily follow, doesn't have a choice in the matter. When you can't pray to them. Because but you can pray to someone who is alive. You can pray to somebody who is characterized by knowledge, will, or power. And so this verse, when it says فَدْعُوهُ مُخْلِصِينَ لَهُ الدِّينَ, it follows from the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who created the universe, is a living being. The ulama of this science, they describe these four attributes, the attributes of qudra, irada, power, will, ilm, knowledge, and life. These attributes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is being characterized by these attributes. They express this by saying that Allah Most High is a living volitional agent. In Arabic we say fa'il mukhtar. The Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a fa'il. Fa'il means someone who has agency. Someone who has agency. There's interesting contemporary research that's done by some Christian psychologists, and they say that human beings, you can Google this, you can read a little bit about this. They say that human beings have within them something they call ADD, an agency detecting device. So these Christian psychologists, philosophers, theologians, one of the ways in which they express the argument by design, the argument for the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from design, is that they say that when we look at the universe, we see evidence, the design in the universe is evidence of agency. It's evidence that things in the universe were made by a volitional agent, somebody who chose to make them that way. That's why we see this precision in the universe. And there's research that's done on this. It's interesting, fascinating research, useful for us to read about and know about. And so agency or an agent, this is what we mean by fa'il. Mukhtar means volitional, somebody who has a volition. This is already there in the meaning of being an agent. An agent only has agency if he has volition. Volition means choice, the ability to choose and determine. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a fa'il mukhtar, not a lifeless cause for the universe. This the falasifa like Ibn Sina, Ibn Rushd, from Aristotle and Neoplatonists who came in between them and Aristotle, they held, like contemporary scientists who are many of them who are theists, that there is a necessary being, but that necessary being is a lifeless cause. It's not someone you can pray to. It's not someone you can worship. But when we say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the attributes of knowledge, will, power, and life, we are saying, in other words, that He is a volitional agent, a fa'il mukhtar, not a lifeless cause, and that He is someone who can be worshipped, and He deserves to be worshipped, and He is somebody who can be asked and supplicated to, and He commands us to supplicate to Him. وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم.